worship on this final Sunday of the season of Easter. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Special welcome to all of you who are here for the baptism of Maya Beth Scott. We're excited to have you with us, and we're excited to welcome Maya into the family of faith today. Will you please join me in an opening prayer? Let's pray. Lord of Lords, illumine our hearts and our minds this day, that we may see you and live into the hope to which you have called us. Amen. Let's stand and let's sing. God meets us in worship this morning, greets us with these words, grace, mercy, and peace to you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's continue to praise God together.
Christ my Savior and my God, we sit on high. I will praise him. He is exalted, forever exalted, and I will praise his name. He is the Lord, forever his truth shall reign. Exalted, the King is exalted on high. I will praise him. He is exalted, forever exalted, and I will praise his name.
Ascension. The text tells us the story of the Ascension. So hear these words from Acts 1, 1 through 11. This is written by Luke. In my former book, Theophilus, I wrote all that Jesus had begun to do and to teach until the day he was taken up to heaven, after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself to them and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command: "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." Then they gathered around him and asked him, "Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel?" He said to them, "It is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." After he said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. They were looking up intently into the sky as he was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them. "Men of Galilee," they said, "why do you stand here looking into the sky? This same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven." The word of the Lord. So, friends, welcome to the book of Acts. Here with our text today, we have the start to volume 2 of Luke's epic retelling of the life and ministry of Jesus and the beginning of the church. Luke does what any good writer would do. To begin, he gives a brief, "here's where we left off" summary. And it's really concise. Essentially, he says, Jesus amazed us all. He taught, he healed, he served, he died, he rose from the dead. And then, for 40 more days, he taught, he healed, he served, and then he rose again. This time, before the disciples' very eyes, feather light into the sky and hidden in the dew of a cloud. The ascension. Luke's words depict a rather fantastical exit, an exit that became an event the church celebrates every year. And to commemorate the day, we, the staff team here, thought that, like with previous church holidays, we should have some bulletin art. And so during our staff meeting this past week, Jeff, Diane, Calvin, and I were for a good 5 minutes drawn into the wacky world of ascension art. And this was a big mistake, because it turns out that ascension art is terrible. Diane found the best of the terrible. It was a Renaissance-esque piece where men in robes were standing on some rocky ground, looking up into the sky, faces in shock at wee human feet poking out of the clouds. You will notice that this week we do not have bulletin art, and that is intentional. We do give some credit to the artist's attempts. The ascension is a hard one to illustrate, and it's a hard concept to describe in writing. For Luke, in Greek, and to a Gentile audience, and then for the translator to put into English, and then for the pastor to put into a sermon for a 21st century audience. What is actually going on here in this story? At first glance, this passage gives us a really two-dimensional reality. So there is an earth beneath, which we inhabit, and a heaven above, which God inhabits. And now, where exactly above does God reside? Like, the mind boggles. though I would posit that there is more than one Christian today who believes that heaven obviously exists directly over the US of A and just above the clouds, but probably still within Earth's gravitational pull, so that if you just pray or sing loud enough or reach your arms high enough, you just might, as some worked up prosperity preacher would rally, you know, bring heaven on down to Earth. I thought that was funny. Okay. Of course, we know that this isn't true. We know that a dichotomy between heaven and earth isn't as clean or clear-cut as it's presented. Right? We know that Michelangelo's Sistine Chapel rendering of God in the clouds above, reaching down to the apathetic Adam, is precisely what it is. It's art and not reality. And even the disciples wouldn't have seen the world in this dichotomy of two distinct layers. They would have seen heaven and earth as more interlocking realities. It's as N.T. Wright says of the Ascension, neither Luke nor the other early Christians thought that Jesus had, upon ascending, suddenly become a primitive spaceman heading off into orbit or beyond, so that if you searched the far reaches of space, you would eventually find him. Nope, nope, nope. There is in this text some obviously symbolic language. Luke mentions Jesus in the clouds because clouds are a familiar image in the Bible that symbolize God's presence. So think of the pillar of clouds and fire that guided the ancient Israelites to the Promised Land, or when the cloud of smoke fills the temple. The cloud represents God's presence. So here in our text, Jesus is with God, one with God. That's what we're being told. In this text, we can also see clear echoes to a prophecy that was made way back in the book of Daniel. And there it says that one like a son of man coming on the clouds of heaven would be introduced to the Ancient of Days and given dominion over all and a kingdom that would never be destroyed. This was a really important and specific Old Testament promise, and it is not far-fetched to think that Luke would remember that promise and intentionally illustrate the ascension here for his readers and for future readers in a way that would assure them and us that the promised one like the Son of Man, who would be given all authority, was most certainly Jesus. Earlier, I said that the disciples and Luke would have seen heaven and earth as more interlocking realities, and it's true. Scripture gives us the idea that for God, heaven and earth are these two not fully separate, but indeed unique and distinct realities. And we know that there is this wider theological movement in Scripture where we see that God's intent is to move these realities even closer together. So in Revelation, we read about a new heaven and a new earth joined fully. The earliest believers would have seen the resurrection of Jesus, Easter, as God's grand start to that effort to bring these two realities closer together. And the disciples themselves would have believed that Jesus, with his risen body, was the first and only being who could fully be at home in both heaven and on earth. And the ascension, ultimately, is a story making sense of a Jesus who can reside in both realities, but who for the time being resides in heaven. So this story is Luke trying to unravel for us the reality of an embodied Jesus who is with us fully and at the same time not yet. So Jesus is with us and with God in a world that's being renewed, and that is the ascension. And then Luke tells us the disciples' response to all of this news. He says the disciples stand there, just looking up, as you do. I mean, I think it's exactly what you might want to do when presented with the rather complicated, unsatisfying, and totally incomplete reality that we live in, right? And then here's where I think Luke is the most intentional storyteller. He tells us two men dressed in white show up and ask the disciples this really obvious question. Why do you stand there looking up at the sky? And it echoes so clearly a scene that Luke writes about in his earlier volume. Mary goes to the tomb looking for Jesus, and two men dressed in white show up and they ask her this obvious question. Why do you look for the living among the dead? It is to say, disciples, Mary, future readers, be aware. You aren't looking for Jesus in the right reality. Or rather, you're looking in the wrong direction. You won't find him among the dead. You won't find him looking up at heaven. Nope. You're to be looking for the risen and ascended Jesus. The Jesus who inhabits our earthly reality in a heavenly way. And then, friends, how do we do this? Well, I think the famous pastor Frederick Buechner's advice here is wise and apt. He says, disciples, pay attention. Stop. Look. Listen. And look in the right direction. To do this, we have to have a certain right posture. Our eyes must be trained on the injustice in the world. Our minds must be laser focused on that last, most important task that Jesus gave us, his Viva la Revolution to the ends of the earth. And so we don't stop and stare up at the sky or behind us or at our screens to distract ourselves from the things that would unsettle or haunt us. Instead, we Christians are a people who act. We move with boldness. We pay attention to the world around us. We do what Luke tells us Jesus did. We teach the truth. We heal. We serve. We die to ourselves and for others, and that's just our Tuesday. And then we get up and we do it all over again on Wednesday. And it's a life that amazes, and it points to a Jesus who lives. And that's not the prosperity gospel, that's just the gospel gospel. It's the word that says God is at work with us in the world, but the work is ours too, and it's not done. And you might think that that sounds like a lot, but don't put your head in the sand or in the clouds. Instead, friends, I invite you to look at the book of Acts. Actually look at it, read it, like maybe read the whole thing. And as you do, pay attention to the disciples, their Viva la Revolution to the ends of the earth. Look at how when they went, wherever they went, Jesus was with them. Present, guiding, healing, speaking, every step of the way. And then see how the church grew. See how the people grew. See how they looked for and found and followed the ascended Jesus. And then, friends, let's do the same. We must do the same. I'll end here today with a poem that will be our prayer. It's by a woman named Kathy Galloway, and it speaks of the ascension and where we ought to be looking to see and find Jesus. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we are always looking for you in the wrong places. Among the good and respectable people, when we should know you are to be found with the poor and disreputable and the outcast. Lord Jesus, we are always looking for you in the wrong places, at a safe distance. But you come so close to us, nearer to us than breathing. We look for you in churchy things, but we are more likely to find you among the pots and pans or around the kitchen table. We look for you in buildings, but you walk crowded streets and shorelines and mountains. Even now, even after Easter, still we insist on trying to find you among the tombstones, among long dead dogmas, in old decaying fears and hurts, in the guilts and resentments we inhabit like a coffin. But the angel said, "Why do you look for him among the dead? He is not here." So Lord Jesus, help us to lay down the grave clothes, roll away the stone, and come out into life here and now. Help us to find you among the living, ahead of us, going to the Galilee we seek. You have wrestled death to the ground, and now there is nowhere we can go, no darkness we can enter, which is not God encompassed. Amen and amen. Friends, let's sing. You can stand.
Our song of response is new to a lot of us, and we haven't sung it in-person church before. So I'll sing the first verse once, and then when I sing it again, feel free to come in together.
Place where we go, and we are always invited to see Jesus, and that is at the table. Here we are met in bread and wine by the great mystery of faith, that Christ has died, Christ is risen, and Christ will come again. Here at the table, we remember that even though the realities of heaven and earth are not fully one, heaven is not far off, and Christ is near. As near as the astronaut bread and wine that you hold in your hand. Friends, Jesus is in the business of helping us to see him, helping us to look in the right direction. He said, "See this bread. It is like my body that will break for you." He said, "Look at this wine. It is like my blood that will be shed for you for your forgiveness." Jesus helps us on our way, points us toward himself in bread and wine, body and blood. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let's pray. Ascended Jesus, help us to find you here today, to really see you, to look in the right direction. May these simple elements of bread and wine, song and friends, a gathering of community that serves and loves, remind us of you. May this meal today sustain us for the work ahead. In your name we pray. Amen. Friends, take, eat, remember, and believe that Christ died for you, rose for you, ascended, and will return for you. Amen and amen.
We are going to sing a closing song that is
in the bulletin, but back on page 3, we're going to sing He is Exalted Again. Please stand. He is exalted.
He is exalted. The King is exalted on high. I will praise him. He is exalted forever, exalted, and I will. He is exalted, the King is exalted on high. I will praise him. He is exalted forever, exalted, and I will praise his name. He is the Lord, forever his truth shall reign. The King is exalted on high.
Receive this blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his face toward you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Praise.